So in previous videos, I've talked about carbohydrate metabolism, and what I want to do now is pick up on pyruvate and continue our study of metabolism by focusing on what happens to pyruvate, one of the products of glycolysis. So pyruvate has three carbons, and these carbons can be oxidized to carbon dioxide in the processes illustrated here. One thing to note is that pyruvate is synthesized in the cytosol in glycolysis, but the oxidation of pyruvate occurs in the mitochondrion. So before we go further, I just want to take a few minutes and talk about the structure of the mitochondrion and what it's like. On the left here, we have an electron micrograph showing a mitochondrion, and on the right is a traditional cartoon diagram of the mitochondrion showing different features of the organelle. So the first thing to notice is that there's an outer membrane. There's two membranes. So we have an outer membrane and an inner membrane. The outer membrane actually is pretty porous to molecules that are polar, and that's because it has a relatively large pores or holes in the membrane, which allow things up to about 5,000 Daltons in weight to cross pretty freely. So the outer membrane is porous. The inner membrane, however, does not have these pores in it, so the inner membrane is impermeable to small polar molecules. So if it's an ion or a thing like pyruvate, it needs a transporter or a channel to get across the inner membrane. The other thing you notice about the inner membrane is that it has these folds in it, or they're called cristae, singular crista, C-R-I-S-T-A. The folds increase the surface area of the inner mitochondrial membrane, and this is important because there's a lot of chemical reactions that happen on the inner membrane, as we will see. So there is then an intermembrane space, which is sort of indicated by the blue here, but you can see that the intermembrane space actually extends towards the center of the mitochondrion because of these folds in the inner mitochondrial membrane. And finally, we've got the matrix, which is just the space enclosed by the inner mitochondrial membrane in there. Now, these figures here show electron tomography images of mitochondria, and this gives you a better sense of what the folds of the inner mitochondrial membrane look like. So on the left-hand side, you can see sort of that traditional view, but if we isolate individual cristae or individual folds of the inner membrane, you can see that actually they're sort of, if I could use this word, they're sort of tubular in that they make sort of mini compartments that are inside, and these can vary in their size. So it looks a little different than the cartoon shown on the previous page, and likewise here you can see it's sort of like the space, the inner membrane space actually extends in the middle of these folds here like this. So it's almost like a little room within the mitochondrion, or a whole bunch of little rooms inside the mitochondrion. Okay, and to finish off the video, I want to introduce this molecule, coenzyme A, and it'll come up a number of times in the remaining metabolism section, so it's good to understand what it looks like. The A stands for adenosine, and so the structure of nucleotides is covered in a different topic, but basically we've got an adenine nitrogenous base here coupled to a sugar with some phosphates. That's a nucleotide, and it's adenosine, and to that nucleotide is attached this pantothenic acid residue, which is derived from vitamin B5, so that's how your body uses that vitamin. And at the top of the molecule, you can see an SH group, or a thiol group. And this is actually the important part of the molecule as far as the chemistry goes, because you can add other smaller molecules onto this thiol group in a thioester linkage. And this is basically the purpose of coenzyme A. You can think of it like a carrier molecule. It's here to shuttle around different smaller molecules and let them undergo reactions. And so a good example of a molecule that's based on coenzyme A is acetyl coenzyme A, where you've got a two carbon acetyl group joined to this thiol through a thioester linkage like this. And it turns out that this thioester linkage, when it is broken, it releases energy. And so you can think of this as a sort of high energy compound, Or you can think of it like the acetyl group being activated such that it's prepared to undergo a subsequent reaction. And so we'll see coenzyme A at various points remaining in the metabolism section. So having introduced mitochondrion and coenzyme A, we can go on to talk about pyruvate oxidation in the next video.